on space technology and machine learning for agriculture. And morning session, we had two speakers, one keynote speaker, Dr. Brian Slater and Dr. Shakti Kumaran Subburailu. And now we have with us Dr. Prashant Srivastav. And let me take an opportunity to introduce him. Dr. Prashant Srivastav, he is an assistant professor in Institute of Environment and Sustainable Development, Banaras Hindu University, India. And let me take a few minutes to introduce about his educational qualifications and his merits. So he has done his bachelor's in science, agricultural science, from Institute of Agricultural Sciences, Banaras Hindu University, Varanasi. He has done his Master's of Science in Environmental Science in School of Environmental Sciences, Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi. And he has completed his doctorate in Civil Engineering from Department of Civil Engineering, University of Bristol, UK. And his specialization was in soil moisture estimation from ESMO satellite and mesoscale model for hydrological applications. And that was funded by British High Commission UK under the Commonwealth Scholarship and Fellowship Plan. So if we see his teaching experience, then he has wide teaching experience since 2007 to till date in Banaras Hindu University since 2015. And he has been affiliated to various institutions as faculty, visiting scientist, science collaborator, or guest faculty, including Space Application Center, NASA, GSFC, Maryland, Department of Geography, BHU, Department of Farm Engineering, Banaras Hindu University again, External Examiner in Allahabad also, BCC, NOAA, Geospatial Center, New York, Department of Geography and Earth Sciences, University of in Wales, UK, Department of Civil Engineering, Malaysia, and ADIT Institute of Technology in Vallabh Vidyanagar, Gujarat. He has supervised four, he is actually supervising four PhD theses. One is completed and three are ongoing, and seven MPhil theses and MTech and MSc dissertation and BSc BTech students also. He has vast research experience as visiting research scientist in NASA, Goddard Space Flight Center, USA, working group partner in NASA JPL, USA, research associate in NASA Space Flight Center, Greenbelt, Maryland, and he has also been awarded CSIR UGC Research Fellowship. Currently, he's involved in so many research projects, more than 10 research projects from various funding agencies. He has already completed three major research projects from various funding agencies, and he has various overseas visits also for academic purpose. And yes, he has almost more than 140 publications in peer-reviewed journals, 7 book chapters, books, 46 book chapters, 75 conferences, and a lot more to his credit. So we are very much happy to have with you us today, Dr. Prashant Srivastav. And today he is going to talk about sensor-based soil moisture deficit estimation and visualization through Android application for agricultural water management. So yes, we are very happy to welcome you here. We have with us our principal investigator, Dr. R.S. Pundir also. So I may request him to say maybe a few words to him, and then we can start with the lecture. Please, sir.
I think, yes, Dr. Rucha, I think I have to say only a few things, though already we have done these things in our inaugural session. But Dr. Prashant, I think we are here and we are interacting first time. So we welcome you to this lecture. And this in this center. This center is under NHP CAST projects, and you might be knowing because you are from the university, very esteemed and very prestigious university. So only thing is that our focus here in this project on market intelligence is on demand, supply, productions, and predictions and price forecast. Okay. And we are trying to understand the methodological aspects as well as its applications. So that the students, because this is under CAST project, so that the students, MSc students and faculty members could understand it and could discuss it with the students in the teaching assignments as well as could take up some projects. Maybe they are thesis projects or maybe other projects or maybe associated in the project wherein these techniques, these methodologies are used. Because this seems to be very unexplored area so far. When we say at least in India side, because you are expert in this area. So we are here to understand these things. And because Dr. Rucha is there, they are already doing this work, good work with the show and some projects are there. But we have only little knowledge. You can say just a layman kind of things, some staff members. And we want application in economics and management in price forecast. So we would like we are very keen to listen to you, and maybe little later we may have some interactions with you with some questions. Questions are normally compiled from the audiences as well as some other questions which we may like to discuss with you. These are few things, and because you know about this NHP CAST projects already, we presume these things. So with these things, once again, welcome you, and we are here to listen. Over to you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. So, Rucha, shall I start my presentation?
Yeah, please, Prashant.
So, it is visible, my presentation?
Yes, it is visible. Yeah, okay. It is visible.
So as Rucha explained about the topic, that my main topic is soil moisture deficit estimation and visualization through Android application for irrigation water management. So it is one of the important topic for nowadays, because in India we know that we have a lot of problem due to groundwater extraction. Now water is going down, and most of the farmers, they are doing flood irrigation. So how to provide a better decision to farmers so that they can use the only optimum amount of water for irrigation, and they also want to know when to irrigate, and they have question how much to irrigate. So through this Android application, we are trying to address this issue. So we know that water energy pool next year is central to sustainable development. For sustainable development, there are three main things, that is water, another one is food, and third one is energy. And demand for all the three is increasing, because it is now we are having a huge population, we are going through urbanization, we are also changing our diet plan and everything. So it is now going to increase because of a lot of demand from the community. And for water, if you know, you already know that agriculture is the largest consumer of water, fresh water resources, and as well as in India also. So how to save this water? So if you go with the food production in India or anywhere in the world, it is mostly dependent on irrigation, either from groundwater or through rainfall. In India, mostly flood irrigation is in practice. Means like farmers in the night, generally they could go to the field whenever there is a requirement of irrigation. They open the tube well and they left it for 2-3 hours so that there is a plenty amount of water in the field, and then they close it. But if you know the things behind the flood irrigation, that there is a lot of pumping happened from the ground, and all the water is not required for the crop growth, because plant need only half of the field capacity. But if you do the flood irrigation, what happened? Amount is generally more than the field capacity, and soil is in the saturation state. So there is a lot of loss of water due to this flood irrigation and high pumping of the groundwater. And we also know that climate is now changing, and there is a rainfall pattern. If you see, it is now very erratic. Sometimes there is a high rainfall, sometimes there is a low rainfall, sometimes there is a deficit year, sometimes there is a surplus year. So whenever there is a deficit, there is a high amount of groundwater pump from the ground. And if you see in last few decades, most of the groundwater table is now going very down. If you see most of the in your places, if you know that there are hand pumps, and now most of the hand pumps are useless because water is going down. So what is the reason of going down those groundwater levels? Because of high pumping from the ground and a lot of utilization. And we know that groundwater is a finite source. It is not like plenty of it is available. And it is its reliable supply is crucial to human survival and sustainable progress. Because if groundwater is depleted, and we'll all go through a water crisis. So now we need to think of the approaches, how to conserve this water, and we can, or how to protect it for the future needs, so that the future generation can use this water. So coming to our sensor technology, in last decade, you can see a lot of dedicated missions are launched only for understanding this hydrological cycle, soil moisture, rainfall, and other things. Like you already maybe heard about that SMOS mission. It is launched in 2009. It is called SMOS mission, SMOS, soil moisture and ocean salinity. Then we have SMAC mission, soil moisture active passive. We have very good mission called GPM, which is called Global Precipitation Mission, and then can be used for our agriculture model development and management. And you can see these satellites are monitoring soil moisture or rainfall every day. So we can do also real-time monitoring of this soil moisture. That can surely improve our irrigation scheduling efficiency. It can also improve our quality, yield, and profit, because if you know that this is the right time to irrigate, then farmer can do the irrigation. And I hope that most of the people are from agriculture background. And if you know that if there is a delay of irrigation for only 2 or 3 days, there is a huge decline in yield because of that requirement by the crop. So if we know what is the right time to irrigate, then it will definitely help to optimize our yield as well as increase our profit. Secondly, if you are using too much water, then and it will also dissolve that pesticide and that fertilizer, and it also cause groundwater contamination. So we need to know how much is the what is the actual amount of water, so that it is only utilized by the crop, not going downward to the groundwater system. Otherwise, it will also have all those contaminants. So considering the above mentioned problem, there are some solutions available from recent advancement in satellite sensors, like by using soil moisture and rainfall. But we need to evaluate those before using it for operational applications. Because for research application is okay, we are doing a lot of things, we are doing a lot of algorithm and everything. But operational means we need to provide something to the government that it will actually happen. If there is a problem in your operational forecast, then it will cause huge losses. So before launching anything for operational application, it is generally going through a rigorous assessment. So towards this, we are developing user-friendly irrigation demand and scheduling applications for your smartphones. And based on it is based on our Earth observation data sets, like your data set and soil hydraulic models that we will discuss in the next few slides. So coming to our soil moisture deficit, what is deficit? If you know, there are few terms, like we know what is field capacity. It is 100, when all the pores of the soils are filled with water, generally we call it field capacity. But saturation is generally slightly above field capacity. And there is also called permanent wilting point, when there is no more water available to the plants. And in between that, there is, you can say, deficiency of water, that we call it soil water deficit or soil moisture deficit. And generally, farmers, if you are going, this MAD is called maximum allowable deficit. It is generally 40 to 50% of available water capacity. And we are trying to have this MAD maintained. Otherwise, what happens if there is a deficiency, lot of deficiency in the water, if this MAD is not maintained, then we can have stress condition for the plants, and it will cause a reduction in yield. So what is actually soil moisture deficit? It is the amount of rain or irrigation needed to bring the soil moisture content back to field capacity. So suppose we have our water soil moisture content in the soil at this level, but making this to field capacity, we need this much of amount of water. And this we call it soil water deficit and or soil moisture deficit. So how to model this soil moisture deficit? So it is actually a soil moisture content based thing. So if you go for the approach, we have two, three things in mind to develop efficient soil moisture deficit and irrigation technique. First thing is accurate soil moisture content. Second is soil hydraulic parameters like field capacity, permanent wilting point, and other hydraulic parameters, and dedicated server. Like it should be available 24/7 to support the database management system and model simulation, so that we can easily forecast at every hourly or every weekly or monthly basis. So from our previous knowledge that we already know, there are number of in situ soil moisture measuring instruments are available. And in if you go a few years back or two, three decades back, then you see that people or farmers generally have a field method to know the soil moisture. They go to the field, they take some soil, and they said, okay, it is like drying up, let's irrigate. So that is a most, we can say, qualitative way of understanding the soil moisture. Then we have developed gravimetric method. It is based on the weight thing. Then we also developed tensiometer, and there is a drawback. So we are going towards more advanced method to model this or estimate this soil moisture. Then we have electrical resistance block that is based on gypsum plate. Then we measure the resistivity, and then we do the soil moisture measurement. Then we have neutron probe. Then we have nighttime domain spectrometer. Then we have impedance-based method like hydro probe. It is an impedance-based method, and it is generally more accurate. And now we have a more advanced instrument called cosmic ray instrument, soil moisture observing system. We call it COSMOS. And this COSMOS and this impedance-based method like hydro probe both are installed in Anand Agricultural University field. So if anybody want to see the system, maybe Rucha can help to demonstrate those system, how it works. But you can see this in Anand Agricultural University. And there are other places also that where this COSMOS and hydroprobe are installed. Like in BHU, we have hydroprobe, soil moisture measuring instrument. But what is the main drawback with in-situ measurements? If you know that these in-situ measurements are discrete measurement, and it is a very point-based measurement, and it is available only at a specific location. So if you are going for a large area, generally this point-based measurement is not adequate. Why? Because field is big, and that probe is you install at a single point, and we know that soil moisture is highly variable. Both spatially, if you see, if you measure moisture at one point, and if you measure moisture at after 2 kilometers, it will be changed. Why? Because there is a conditions different. One farmer is having you can say wheat crop, other one is sowing some vegetable. And if you see the water requirement of both the crops are different. So it is highly variable. And it is also variably temporal, because you know in summer soil moisture is different. So you have to provide more irrigation. In winter it is different. In rainy season it is different. So soil moisture is highly variable, both spatially and temporally. And in situ cannot solve our purpose. So what is the solution to this? Solution to this is satellite-based soil moisture retrieval. So here, we have number of models available that we categorize into two. We call it inverse model or forward model. And in our case, we are generally using forward model for soil moisture retrieval. And it will go through several processes. Like first we estimate soil water dielectric mixing things in the soil. Then we go for dielectric soil constant estimation. Then we have reflectivity model like Fresnel equation. And then we go for the radiative transfers over smooth surface. Then we, because it is smooth surface is ideal condition, and we don't have ideal condition on the surface or in the agricultural condition. So because of the crop, there is some roughness over there, and it highly impact our soil moisture estimation from satellite. So we had to incorporate our roughness also. Then we do the modeling for rough surface. Then we see the canopy also, because if there is a canopy or agriculture crop over there, then it will affect our soil moisture retrieval. And then we have also temperature thing, because if high temperature, there is a lot of soil moisture loss. And if there is a low temperature, then soil moisture losses are less. And then we have impact of both. And then we do the radiative transfer for complete land, means with soil, canopy and everything. Then we also try to estimate sky and atmospheric contribution. And then we get overall what is the total radiative transfer over from that surface, and that this parameter we use for soil moisture estimation. So here there's already mentioned that there are two main dedicated missions for soil moisture. One is soil moisture and ocean salinity, and other one is soil moisture active passive that is launched in 2015. And if you see the importance of both the mission, that both are dedicated to soil moisture, means both ESA, like European Space Agency and NASA, realizes that soil moisture is very important, not only for irrigation, but only, it is required for many, many things. Like soil moisture is needed in defense application. Like defense people want to know from where is the soil depth is very high, where soil dampness is low so that they can move their troops. Similarly, in weather, if soil moisture is high, then it also impact our rainfall processes. Similarly, in our agriculture water management that I'm going to tell about irrigation and other things. So it is also impact our landslides. If soil moisture is high, then there is a high chance of landslide. So you can see it have a lot of application in weather, climate, defense, agriculture, so many places. So ESA and NASA both launched their own satellite for soil moisture. I hope ISRO will also taking the same direction, that they will also launch some dedicated satellite at higher resolution. And I think NASA upcoming NASA ISRO synthetic aperture radar will solve some of these issues. But both are the mission providing Earth soil moisture fields. So this is as you can see, both are 1.4 gigahertz satellite radiometers. This is SMOS and this is SMAP, and both are providing soil moisture over the globe. But you know, both other satellite are providing global soil moisture. And if you see India, and if you compare with the European and US condition, in US most of the fields are homogeneous. Homogeneous means they are very large hectares of field. So over variation of soil moisture is not that much. But if you see India, where we have high heterogeneity, means every few kilometer or every half kilometer we have change in crops. So we need to assess these satellite product over India, whether it is performing good or not. If it is not performing good, we need to calibrate or develop our own model for soil moisture retrieval in India. So that if we have a good soil moisture, accurate soil moisture over our surfaces, then we can improve our soil moisture deficit calculation accurately. So how we can do that? If you go with the soil moisture retrieval algorithm, so it is basically, as I told about, it is basically follow that forward modeling. And in forward modeling, we need to model this brightness temperature. So how this brightness temperature we model? We model using emissivity and temperature. This is a physical temperature. And this physical temperature we can obtain from the soil surface by using a thermometer or by using any other satellite. And then we have emissivity, it is based on vegetation. And when we calculated both, we can monitor this this brightness temperature. And for calculating emissivity, you can see it is a difference from one, we call it reflectivity. And we need to calculate this reflectivity. So every whole equation is to calculate this reflectivity parameter. And it is for, you can see, sorry, it is for bare soil surface. Bare soil surface, we are assuming here that there is a no crop over there. And for this reflectivity, we need to have some dielectric mixing model that I mentioned in our one of the flow chart. And for this dielectric mixing model, we have different polarization. Like if you see that small satellite, we have two polarization. One is H, horizontal polarization, and other one is V, we call it vertical polarization. So for modeling this smooth surface reflectivity, we are using Fresnel equation. We calculate this dielectric mixing model, and then this MOS is seeing the Earth at 40 degree angle. So we put this 40 degree angle over here, 40 degree here, and we have this dielectric mixing model that is based on our soil condition. Like here S is sand and C is clay percentage. And once we have this sand and clay percentage and then variation in soil moisture, then we can calculate the dielectric mixing model, and then we can incorporate roughness parameter over here. And this roughness parameter gives us emissivity, and this emissivity we needed for this what we call brightness temperature calculation. So once we have this emissivity, one minus this emissivity will give us reflectivity, and that we can use for our brightness temperature simulation. So we have brightness temperature from the ground. Here everything is from the ground, and we have satellite measured brightness temperature. We calculate a difference and then trying to link with the our soil moisture range. So where we have getting the least error with the soil moisture correlation, then that is the actual soil moisture value over the ground. So I hope you understand this. Maybe if you have some confusion, you can discuss this to me later also. But what is the main problem? That we don't have only soil surface. We also have vegetation, like we have a lot of crop, forest, and other thing. We have also sky portion. Sky is also having some this reflection impact this reflection. But in L band, like SMOS is a L band. In L band, reflection is generally from sky contribution, we generally neglect it. So we have only model soil vegetation and soil vegetation interaction. So here you can see for my monitoring of vegetation, we have this soil parameter, then we have this vegetation, this part, and then we have vegetation soil both. And then we have a sky parameter that we are neglecting in this case because contribution is sky is zero. So this term becomes zero. And now we need to model here like transmissivity, we need to model soil temperature, we need to model vegetation temperature, we need to model with this vegetation scattering albedo. So if we have all the three things, then we can have brightness temperature over the earth, and then we can easily simulate our soil moisture. So here, if you modified that previous model for only crops, because here we are talking about agriculture. So we are going with the simplification of that model for only crop that we call as tau omega model. So if you see tau omega model, we simplified those things. And if you see, we have scattering albedo, P is polarization. Because it's SMOS, if it's satellite, we have H polarization data available, we have B polarization data available. It is up to you what you want to use. We have transmissivity and we have this reflectivity parameter. And we, if we have all these parameters, then we can monitor this brightness temperature. And for this transmissivity, we have this vegetation optical depth. And for vegetation optical depth, we have a simple relation that we will see next slide. And in crop condition, like in low height crops like wheat or you can say paddy, we are considering the temperature of canopy, that is top of the canopy, top of the soil, crop surface, and soil, ground, both are equal. So we can easily replace this term with the one temperature only, either with the canopy temperature or with the soil temperature to simplify that model. So once we have simplified that model, then we can have this temperature. We already know how to calculate reflectivity using the equation of the electric mixing model, and we can calculate transmissivity using vegetation optical depth. So here, for calculating the dielectric model, like we already discussed, the simplest one that we call Helikainen, you know that soil percentage, clay percentage, that is a Helikainen model. So that is the simplest model that can be used for the dielectric mixing model. Similarly, we have many models available, but our research shows that Mironov model is the best for soil dielectric mixing model calculation. For trial and error purpose, you can also use Helikainen to understand the model. So once we have all those parameters, like we need this scattering albedo, we need transmissivity, we need reflectivity, we can model soil moisture. So how to calculate all those parameters? So we need first roughness parameter, because I told that no surface is perfectly smooth because of crop and tillage and other thing, soil is generally rough. And for those, we need to calculate this roughness parameter, otherwise your soil moisture is not accurate. Again, we need vegetation water content to simulate this vegetation optical depth. This parameter is vegetation optical depth, and for this we need vegetation water content, and also we need also vegetation excreting albedo. So you can see how we can estimate roughness in the field. We have a grid board, 1 centimeter grid board, and here we put on a surface, we clear this portion 1 by 1 meter, we take the photograph, and then we digitize it to get this root mean square height and correlation length to estimate this R, H, and Q parameter. This is roughness parameter. So once this roughness parameter is estimated, we can estimate this rough surface reflectivity. Because I told no surface is smooth, we need to quantify rough surface reflectivity to accurately model our soil moisture. Again, vegetation water content, we know that there are destructive methods available for vegetation water content. What we do, we go to the field, cut 1 meter by 1 meter vegetation, take that to the lab, weigh it, take the wet weight, then we take the dry weight. After drying it for 3 days at 70 degrees centigrade, and after calculating the difference, we can get vegetation water content. And this vegetation water content, we can express in kilogram per meter square or other thing. But we also developed other relation based on satellite, because it is not possible every time to go to the field, cut vegetation and calculate vegetation water content. So there is a method available based on leaf area index. So there is a relation between leaf area index and vegetation water content, and leaf area index can be easily estimated using satellite. And by using that LAI, we can estimate this vegetation water content. So this, when we have this vegetation water content, then we can estimate this vegetation optical depth. So after that, we have this coefficient available. If you see the papers from Jackson et al, then they already developed this parameter for agriculture, and it is around 0.12 for crop. So when we multiply our field estimated vegetation water content either by using LAI or by using our destructive method multiplied by BP, then we can guess this vegetation optical depth. So 0.12 is for this crop condition, and it will give vegetation optical depth. And after for single scattering albedo, we have our own Indian researcher in NASA that developed that for single scattering albedo. It is generally less than zero. And for if you see for bare soil or low vegetation, like either with no crop or very short high crop like paddy or our agricultural crop, we can take it zero. So in our that equation, in this equation, we remove this parameter by zero, and then we already calculated by using this vegetation optical depth, and then we have this data from our you can say ground measured instrument or by using a satellite. And then you can use the estimate brightness temperature, and this brightness temperature is directly related to our soil moisture. So we monitor all those parameters, and this VWC that I already told that you can also use NDVI, normalized difference vegetation index, or LAI to quantify this VWC, because every time cutting vegetation is not possible, and it is only possible for small areas. But if you are going to do soil moisture interval for a large area, we need some large scale product like some satellite products. So once we have scattering albedo, we tried all the model. Then we tested our what are the best dielectric mixing model, like Mirono is the best. You can see it, this one is the best because it is close to our reference. And then we simulated soil moisture fall over all over India to see whether what is the soil moisture variation over India. And after that, then we go for our soil moisture deficit development. So if you see soil moisture deficit, I already told it is the amount of water required to bring soil moisture to field capacity. So we need two terms here. One is field capacity, and second one is soil moisture content. We already saw a detail about how to estimate the soil moisture content using Tau Omega model or using forward algorithm. You see all the parameters needed for this soil moisture content estimation. So once we have our own soil moisture content for India, high resolution, then we have field capacity. And with this field capacity, we can calculate using the Rosetta model. And then we can have hydrous model available to quantify that you can say the pressure heads, then we can get this permanent wilting and field capacity point to calculate this soil moisture deficit. So you know what is the available soil moisture content in the soil, you know the field capacity of the soil, because you know if you go with the literature for there is already data available to show that for clay soil this much field capacity is there. For sandy loam, already field capacity is, they already derive what is the field capacity. For loamy soil, field capacity is already defined. So either you go for your literature, or you can have this Rosetta model to calculate field capacity. In our case, we use Rosetta model because sometimes the things available in literature is not always true, because things are changed, soil have different porosity. Even in loamy sand, soil range is different, so the porosity is different. So if field capacity vary, your SMD vary. So in our case, we calculate our field capacity using Rosetta model. And in hydrous, we try to simulate what is the actual requirement of the crop with respect to soil moisture or water content. Because all soil, all crops have different water content requirement. So if you do a rigorous experiment, you will find that that crop don't need field irrigation up to the field capacity. Most of the crop are giving optimum yield even if you give irrigation up to 50% of the field capacity. So what we did in our model, that instead of taking the full field capacity, we take 50% of the field capacity. And when we subtract it from the SMC, we know the what is the requirement of particular crop for irrigation. So here we did the experiment with different irrigation, and we also tried to find the yield. And we see there is a wilting point and there is a field capacity, and we provided different, you can say, treatment of irrigation. So even we provide irrigation up to field capacity, we provide half of the field capacity, we provide 75% of the field capacity, we provide 25% of the field capacity, and try to see what is the response of crop with respect to yield. And we saw that in 3-4 control plots we had tried that even with 50% of field capacity, our yield is good, means yield is optimum, like with the full field capacity irrigation. So it is suggested that whenever we are doing irrigation in our field, it's like we are doing the flood irrigation. We are filling the soil pore with the water. And if you see, that much water is not required, because if you are doing flood irrigation, filling all the soil pores, that is not required by the crops. They need only 50% of that. So how to define that soil moisture deficit? So already told, with this equation, we can estimate this soil moisture deficit, and we need to know the field capacity. That is, and after knowing the field capacity, using this pressure head method, that we know that at -125 or -1200 MPa, there is a permanent wilting point and there is a field capacity. And if after quantifying this field capacity, we can put over here half of that, and we already know how to calculate this soil moisture using the satellite, and then we can get soil moisture deficit. So here, if you see this, we have different validation sites that whether our work is or whether this app is giving good result is not. We have set up around 60 sampling points in the Varanasi region, and we are measuring soil moisture at each point every 15 days. And we are also simulating this soil moisture deficit every 15 days to see whether this is giving what is the deficiency in the region. And we have also sensor installed with the help of DIC Design Innovation Center, sponsored by ISRO. And we have also provided instrument by Space Application Center called HydraProbe, and we install at different depth. With the ISRO scientists, we install this instrument in the agricultural field, and we are also measuring every 15 days to see what is the soil moisture status. And then we compare with our soil moisture deficit that we calculated using our methodology. So once we calculate and when validate, then we release it for the public use. So if you see the model, that this is an irrigation scheduler. We have different sites, around 60 sites in the Varanasi region. We started as a prototype from the Varanasi region. We have all the institute data like village name, latitude, longitude, soil type, because we need this soil type so that we can put in the Halicanon model. Soil type means soil sand percentage, clay percentage, all those things. Then we retrieve soil moisture, and we retrieve soil moisture deficit. We have MySQL database, then we have different launcher like main activity, soil moisture, and database helper, Google Map activity. That one of my student, Ms. Prachi Singh, helped me a lot with this app development. Then we have also this Android Studio platform that connected with the different Amazon-based server. And then we ultimately we execute this model and provide soil moisture deficit by using our methodology that I showed above. So it will give you the soil moisture deficit value. If you click any of the point, it will give you a soil moisture deficit, soil type in that region, it will give latitude, longitude, and what is the actual soil moisture exists over there. So by combining all this platform, this methodology, lot of algorithm, you can get this soil moisture over this soil moisture deficit over this area. So here, there are some background, what is the platform available for this Android app. Like we have this application program interface, we have used Android Studio 3.1.4. We also have this KitKat Lollipop and Marshmallows, like other thing that is available to support this mobile app. And we have different library module like Java, Manifest, REST. It is all required to wrap up this model. And this is the Android Studio that is also used in this to build this model. And if you see, this is the layout of this irrigation scheduler that I showed above. This, if you enter this, then you will get a region over here. Then you will get all the deficiency and the status in that region. And now we are expanding this to country level. So we have other test site available with the help of ISRO. So we are trying to see what is the performance of this irrigation scheduler at different test site and different region. Because in India, we have a lot of different agroclimatic zones. So maybe model performance difference. So we have to test before releasing it for whole India. So conclusion is that because of increasing demand of food and water security and how high population, we need our effective irrigation management practice to save our time, cost. This help will be helpful to know about the soil moisture related information from the defined location in real time. It can also provide farmers how much to irrigate and thus beneficial in crop water management, because farmers now know what is the actual amount of irrigation. And because it is a smartphone based app, and now phone is available in very nominal cost. Even if you go for even 1500 or 2000, you will get a smartphone. So you can easily install this app in your smartphone. And after that, just click it and you will know what is the irrigation requirement here. Now we are also having support from the hydroclimatic services, MD Pune. They are providing us the forecast data of rainfall, 5 days, 15 days, and 30 days like this. So we are also giving the forecast of soil moisture deficit, that what is going to be the condition in 5 days, 15 days, or 30 days, so that government can provide cost-effective decision whether there will be loss in the coming months or there will be a surplus amount of water. So this way they can also develop their crop insurance schemes, so that farmers, those who are getting loss, they get crop insurance. And because, you know, condition of farm in India is not that good, and because sometimes rainfall is erratic, sometimes irrigation is not proper, and they are going through a lot of crisis because of drought-like situation or flood-like situation. So crop insurance can help them to improve their life. So this will have a lot of application, and it is very easy to operate by the end user. And we are also providing many more features in the coming months, once we have all the things to us, because we are trying to have data for other reasons also. So it will give you better performance, because in Varanasi, what we did, we did also soil texture and soil type measurement using our, you can say, Buchas hydrometer and that methodology in our lab. And if you see that FAO soil database, that is very old. So we need new database for a country like India. So we are also in touch with NBSS, LUP. They will provide us some of the data to improve our model for at least the state and country level. So it will provide much better result. And it will also beneficial to both government agencies, irrigation planner, and state governments. So that's it. Thank you. We like to thank Design Innovation Center, MHRD. This is a funded center to us in BHU. And also like to thank Space Application Center for providing funding for this research. And thank you. And if you have any questions, please ask.
Yes, Prashant, thank you very much. We have some of the questions here, which I'm just putting in chat box. And
so shall I stop sharing my screen?
Yeah. But I'll just put the questions in chat box. Yes. Is it visible?
Yes. Could you suggest mathematical model for continuous water monitoring in plant vegetation?
Yes.
So here we have this what we called Rosetta model that I suggested, and it is available, you can see, free of cost. So if you have this Rosetta model, then you can calculate this field capacity. And the mathematical model that I developed for soil moisture retrieval, it is also available for global soil moisture retrieval. From, you can say, if you go with the okay, shall I finish first one, or do you want to go with the second one?
No, you can finish first one and then.
Okay. So for that, you can also have that code available for the large scale soil moisture retrieval. But I just I suggested that if you are going to apply in India, it will not help you much, because in India heterogeneity is very high. Those model is very good for you can say large scale regions, like where we have very big fields, but not for the small heterogeneous plots. So here we need our high resolution soil moisture first thing. And for high resolution soil moisture, we need high resolution database that, which is available for Indian region. Calibrate our model parameter, simulate soil moisture, get field capacity from the Rosetta model, couple it, then you will get it. Best water monitoring other thing in plant and vegetation. And there are number of sensors also available, but I told both sensors are point location. You need to have means satellite data to get those parameters. It will help both plant and vegetation. It's okay. First question.
Yes.
Okay. So what are different model methods are used to estimate soil moisture using optical and thermal remote sensing data?
Yes.
So there are plenty of methods available. So here, if you go with the first paper like Toby Carlson, that published in 30 years back, that we call T.N. Carlson paper. So they develop a triangle method that based on NDVI and temperature. So what they are doing, they are trying to find a wettage, they are trying to find a dry edge. Then they have fit the regression line over there. By using that NDVI, LST, dry and wet edge, then they put that Chaudhary model. There is a empirical relation given, SM and LST. You have to find a coefficient from that triangle method. Put that coefficient in Chaudhary and, equations, and then you will get soil moisture. But what is the problem? Because it is quite old method. And now we are shifting to microwave, because this optical and thermal remote sensing based methods are only providing soil moisture up to 1 centimeter or 2 centimeter depth, because their penetration power is very less. And by realizing those problems, both ESA and NASA, now they released this microwave based satellites things, so that because they have L band, their penetration power is much, even in our Varanasi condition, because soil is alluvial, it is going up to 10 to 15 centimeter penetration depth. So microbe is much better than this optical and thermal, because its penetration power is more. If you do the accuracy of this thermal and optical is around 90%, but if you go by the element, it is 98% accurate, only 2% error is there. Secondly, microbe is available day and night. You can also monitor in a night time, you can also monitor in a daytime. So if you go in the defense application, they also need soil moisture data in the night time, because if there is some attack or something during the night, they know what is the soil moisture status. They know where to pass the troop and everything. So microbe has several benefits as compared to thermal optical, but they have some other advantage also optical and thermal infrared, because they are very high resolution. You can get soil moisture up to 30 meter with Landsat and up to 12 meter with Sentinel. But again, temporal is poor. You will get every 16 days. Microwave, we will get every day. So there are many methods and models available. Just put triangle method in Google and put TB Carlson, TN Carlson, then you will get all the methodology. Okay. Yes, how soil moisture requirement varies for different curve and how to identify the same. That's we need to do experiment over here. That for wheat crop, we did it. For we are also doing for the sugarcane crop, and for wheat crop and sugarcane crop, it is find that around 50% of field capacity yield is optimum. For paddy crop, experiment is still going on, and with pulses we haven't started it. But we have field now with us available this year, so we will do with the pulses also. So with different crop, requirement is different. Yes, just I discussed how does these data help to agriculture insurance agencies. Like we told, I discussed that if you know the soil moisture stress in the soil, then that stress also affected on the crop. Suppose there is a drought condition is going to happen, soil moisture is going to deplete in coming days because of no rainfall or poor irrigation. Then what happened? There is a loss in the coming months. So if we know what is the losses, then we can develop crop insurance scheme according to that, and it will help agricultural insurance agency to provide proper compensation to the farmers. So that why government is also trying to know what is the yield this year, what is the yield next year, and they, that way they are doing this insurance schemes. That is based on this. How to solve the problem of irrigation inability or limited facility? So this irrigation here, if you see that that I mentioned, that is not a only technique related problem, but also a planning related problem also. Here we see most of the farmer that I mentioned, maybe some of you also belong to agricultural side. So if you know, if you go to the field or if you ask your friends, those who are doing the farming activities, you will see that they generally how when they are irrigating, they are going in the night 3 or 4 o'clock, they open the pump and then they left it for 3-4 hours. And then when there is a water on in the field up to the top, then they close the pump. But I suggested that only 50% of that water is needed. We don't need water up to saturation. We need water up to only 50% field capacity. So if we run that pump only for 1 hour, one hour to meet that what you call 50% of that field capacity, then we can have that lot of irrigation, save lot of irrigation water or groundwater. And with the help of this app, what we are trying to do, we are trying to tell farmer that this is the this must is a deficiency in your field. So by calculating the height of the deficiency, they can manage this irrigation problem. So it need both from the, you can say, farmer side as well as from our side also, that our pump don't have that timing facilities, our pump don't have that closing facilities using the what you call smart app. So in DIC also, like in Design Innovation Center that sponsored to us in BHU, one or two students are developing automatic shut off pump device. So it will, what have to do, you have to just start your pump and set the timer. After 1 hour it will be off. And again, there is a calculation for the how much water is pumping out from the ground. So there is a volume based equations over there. What is the volume of water pumping per meter cube per second, and with the help of that we know what is the volume of water going in the field. So if you know the field size, we know the what of the volume of water going in the field, and we can easily decide the depth of the water and the requirement. So in this way we can save it. So irrigation in case of this, that we need both from our side and both from the other side. Otherwise there are other we can say solutions are also trying by the government, like river linking project and other thing. So for example, Bundelkhand region, one of my PhD student is doing PhD over there. And if you see Bundelkhand region, it is a drought prone region. And in drought prone region, there is a problem of irrigation because over there groundwater is not that much, irrigation is not, rainfall is not that much. So for those reasons, there will be a, some solution from the river linking. But for those areas where, like in northern India, like in other Chennai over there, they are doing this flood irrigation, and we need can save lot of water, because what happened, we are also using the river water for irrigation. And if you are extracting lot of water for the irrigation, that will also create a lot of loss from the river side also. So it will save water from the river, it will save water from the ground, this approach. And for the drought prone region, we need to think about the river linking, other possible options. Yes, how machine learning can be used for soil moisture estimation? So in Rosetta model, if you see previously, we are trying, you can say, simple linear regression method to calculate this field capacity. But if you see the our environmental problems, most of the relations are non-linear. Non-linear means you will not find a straight line. You will find a curve line or something. And for non-linear relation things, it is not good to use a linear model, because it will create a lot of error in your data set. So for that, we are using machine learning. For in Rosetta, we are using this, what you call an artificial neural network. So what is it using? It is trying to have the organic carbon data, it is trying to have the other available data set, meteorological data set. We are also trying to put soil texture. We are also trying to put pressure heads. Then it build a in ANN, try to predict that field capacity based on this ANN and bootstrap method. So it, in field capacity, it is now much improved as compared to our previous approaches. Again, in our sensor methodology that we are doing for the sensor based, you can say automation technique, like it is our Internet of Thing method, that in this method, we connected so many sensors, and sensor soil moisture data is going to the our AI tool like artificial neural network or relevance vector machines, support vector machines. There are a number of techniques available that we are using. We are trying to link with soil moisture. We have hydrological balance based soil moisture deficit. We are building a relation, and then we are forecasting soil moisture deficit. So if you search soil moisture deficit and artificial or machine learning in Google, then you will find some of my paper where I use artificial intelligence to calculate soil moisture deficit or to predict soil moisture deficit using small soil moisture. Similarly, we are trying with the SMAP and our other methods. So here there are several machine learning, you can say, approaches available, both to improve your model insight and both you can do from the outside also, means just have hydrological balance space, like I used probability distributed model to calculate SMD, soil moisture deficit. We have small data sets. We implemented a number of artificial intelligence technique like relevance vector machine, support vector machine, ANN. We also tried like generalized linear models. Then we build equations and then we forecasted for one catchment, what is the SMD level. And then if you have forecasted soil moisture or data or rainfall data, you can also put in that artificial or machine learning method. Then it will improve your forecasting of soil moisture deficit, or you can say soil moisture, both. So there are approaches available.
Okay, there is one more question.
Okay. So if they have one more question. It is free of cost. Because what we are doing, can we make automated soil moisture based irrigation facility available on farmer at low cost? Because I'm telling you, it is a smartphone based app. It is now, we already have high resolution soil moisture. We already have map for like field capacity and everything. So it is now available to farmer at low cost. Now, what we are trying to do, we are trying to make it more crop specific. Currently we have for wheat and paddy, because these are the two major staple crop grown in India. Like if you see paddy and wheat, both are the staple crops. Now we are trying to have few more crops like pulses, like if you see that tur dal and other thing that is used by the common people, that we are going to do. But initially it is for wheat and paddy and sugar cane, and we will go for few more crops that is grown by majority by India. And we have soil moisture data available. We have now field capacity. And now we can calculate all those things. Now we need to find only what is the irrigation requirement of those crops and their yield. Whether they are giving yield at 40% of field capacity, optimum yield, or 60% of field capacity, or 70% of field capacity, that we need to quantify. Once we know this by setting several trials, then we can give for different crops also, but it is available. It is very low cost. This app will be available maybe in a couple of 2-3 months after some more trials. And just you need to download, put in your smartphone, it will give you the things. Actually, it is for farmers. So because now everybody has smartphone, and if not, then government may start some scheme, give through Krishi Vigyan Kendra or something, give a smartphone to a Pradhan or 3-4 representative people over there. Farmers can go to Pradhan or some more people over there and ask what is the irrigation requirement for my crop. He will tell, and then it's all the purpose. If they are not providing phone to everybody, at least they can provide low cost phone to village head.
Okay, one more question.
How this soil moisture can be used for market intelligence? So, but actually what he want to ask over here means
Because this project is for market intelligence. So how maybe he wants to ask how soil moisture estimation or how soil moisture product can be useful for suppose price of the crop or like that market intelligence. How we can connect it with market intelligence.
That I can tell that with the insurance scheme that if we are going to facing drought condition in near future, then we are going to have that loss in crops also. So maybe same way we can increase that MSP price of the crop, increase the MSP price of the crop for that year. So that likewise it sometimes happened, onion is very costly because it's now 80 rupees. Previously it was 25 rupees. So it is like if you're going to face loss in the coming months, then we can increase the means the cost of the our crops. So it can regulate the insurance schemes also. So it can help in that crop insurance, and of course it can be directly related to market intelligence also, because we can quantify the losses, we can quantify the profits also. So if there is a lot of profit, then we can have more buffer stock. For that reason, we can also export. So that year we can have more export income to us. But if we are going to face losses, then we can have provide strategy according that this year we will increase the cost of the crop, or maybe we will not import this year. So it will accordingly we can do that.
Yes. So, but how exactly soil moisture will play the role for this? Maybe he wants to ask this.
So that soil moisture that I'm telling that if we know the soil moisture deficit, then yes. Through this we also know that crop is going to be in stress condition.
Yes.
If crop is in stress condition, then there will be it will also impact our yield. Mm-hmm. If yield is less, then it will of course impact our market. Impact
whether we want to go for export or import.
Import, everything will be impacted.
Yes.
So that's why they are using this crop insurance thing, that there is a number of indices available based on soil moisture that can be directly linked to this, you can stress. And if there is stress to the crop, then I told you, even if there is a two, three days delay in the irrigation, it impact our yield. Okay. So if there is a prolonged delay of soil moisture in the field, then it will cause us a lot of losses in the yield.
Yes. Yeah, I think that is the question session is... There is no more questions.
One more question?
No. Okay. We have covered almost all the questions.
So if they have any more question or something, they can ask me directly on my email. And yeah. If they have some problem with the algorithm or how they can use those algorithms, then I can help with that also.
Yeah, some of the participants are asking for your email ID. So we'll just post it in that live chat, your email ID. Is it okay?
Okay, it's okay. And they can ask me anytime, no problem.
Okay.
There are people lurking over here also. They can help with there. If they are doing some research or something, they can help also.
Sure.
So it is possible. Because of this, we are also getting interacted with the students and everything. Yes. Because sometimes they ask a lot of good problems. So let us to think what is the new challenges.
Yes.
So it's good. They are asking, and I can say they are asking several good questions. So it's good.
Yeah. Yeah, that's it. Yeah. So Preeti, are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, Preeti, I would like you to thank on behalf of. Yes.
Thank you very much, Dr. Prashant, for your nice explanation, not just in terms of your presentation, also taking those questions and explaining those pros and cons related to that particular question. That was really nice. And we, from my on behalf of my whole team, I really want to thank you for this nice session. So thank you, Dr. Prashant.
Thank you, Dr. Pundi sir, and Rucha and Preeti and whole team, and especially the head team, to allow me to speak on this platform. And it is really a good interaction, and all the best for the program. This program is really good, and I hope students will learn through this program. So
yes.
Thank you all.
Thanks, Prashant, for sparing the time. And even this lecture will be there on YouTube, so people would be able to see the lecture afterwards also. So that is also one of the good thing that it can be viewed afterwards. If someone is not able to join this, then they can see it later on also.
Okay, perfect. And if they have any question, just send me an email.
Yeah. I'll just put in your email ID in that live chat. Yeah.
Okay.
Thanks, Prashant. Thank you.
Now?